Hey there, is today your first time here? Or maybe your first time in a while? If so, maybe you're wondering exactly who we are and what this church is all about. Well, we'd like you to know that we're a group of ordinary people who are on an amazing journey together, following Christ. Our guide is the Bible because it's the divinely inspired word of God, and it will never take us in the wrong direction. Along the way, we hope you'll see that we are welcoming and spiritually passionate, and that getting to know you is a big deal to us. We know that the road is rough sometimes, but we'll work really hard to bring you practical and relevant messages to equip and encourage you through life's ups and downs. We want you to know that we care about this community, and we believe that it's our job to make it a better place. So, no matter who you are or where you've been, we're glad you're here with us today. And we hope that you'll join us on our journey, following Christ and living out His plan for us. So, welcome to church.
Praise the Lord, church. No, I didn't say whisper, church. I said praise the Lord, church. Can we pause and just praise the Lord this morning? God has been so faithful to us. He has been good to us. God has been long-standing with us and long-suffering with us. Isn't God good this morning? If you are grateful that He woke you up this morning and started you on your way, allowed your feet to touch the ground, you can wiggle your fingers, you made decisions this morning, we ought to thank the gracious and good and glorifying God. Let's thank God. Now, I wasn't tasked to lead praise, but I've got to praise because I can't help it. I'm so grateful for God. Amen. When I wake up in the morning, I don't have to wait to get a check to say thank you, God. I don't have to wait to avoid a car accident to thank God. As soon as my eyes open, I check to see if my toes can wiggle. I check to see if I can think and if I can move. And if my feet touch the ground, I've got enough, even before I brush my teeth, to say thank you, Jesus. Beni suelet en el. Gracias, Señor. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness. Amen. God has been good to me, to us, to Shiloh, to all the young people of this area, and we are grateful for the awesome God that we serve. Amen. Man, rain doesn't deter us because we are grateful. Amen. I've got to pray. Let's pray. Father in heaven, God, we are so grateful to be in your presence. God, there are some people who could not make it out this morning. But Father, we're so grateful that we are able to re-enter into this amazing building. And it's not just the Shiloh Church, but it is your home. It's the place that you dwell. And Father, we're so grateful that you were excited to meet us, your children. Father, there is nothing that we could have done. There is no sin that we could have out-sinned to get you upset to not want to see us. Father, despite our ways and our attitudes and the decisions that we've made, you are still excited to welcome us home. And so, Father, we thank you that redemption is here and forgiveness is here and love is here. Rejoicing is here. Happiness and healing is in the house. And so, Father, I pray in a special way, God, that we would feel freed and liberated and a little bit lighter today. Father, someone came for something that they can't even express in words because they're hurting and damaged and depressed. But God, we thank you that you can do everything at the same time. And so, Father, be more than Dr. Phil to us and more encouraging than Oprah to us and give us more healing than the best chief resident in this area. And Father, I pray that you give us comfort better than the Ritz-Carlton. Father, I pray today that we would say, if we didn't see anybody else, we saw Jesus. And so, Father, I thank you for this thing. And I thank you that a young person is going to stop smoking weed today. I thank you that a young person is going to stop a relationship that's damaging today. Father, I thank you that someone's grades that have failed them can't outfail them. Father, I thank you for someone who is in the course of bad decision-making that they can say today they experienced a U-turn. Father, come nigh unto us today and bless us beyond measure. Father, we say thank you in no other name but the name of Jesus. Let everyone not speak, not whisper, but shout the words, amen. Shout the words, amen. Give God a hand praise in this place.
I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I was excited when they said unto me, enter into the rest of his Sabbath. I don't know about you, but I work hard all week long. And so when it comes time on Friday evening to shut it down and to turn it up for Jesus, I get excited because I know that I serve a God. I know that I serve a God who saves, a God who rested and is resurrected, and a God who says, enter into my rest. And we enter into his house on this Sabbath day. I'm here to welcome you into Shiloh this morning. Welcome to all of our Shiloh family that is here, those that are joining online. A special welcome to the Chicagoland Youth and Young Adult Federation for joining us here for worship today. It is good to see you. It is good to have you. And I so much enjoy seeing our Pathfinders come in this morning looking bright and sunshiny. I am so excited that this is all about our young people today. Let us praise God for our young people today. Now, just a few notes of housekeeping this morning before I allow the Youth Federation to completely take over the program, and I am happy to let them take over the program. But just a few notes of housekeeping. First and foremost, we also want to welcome our Pastor Baldwin and his wife, who will be bringing us the word this morning. So good to have you in our presence this morning. His wife, Trinica, his daughter that are there, we thank you so much for joining us today. For prayer meeting for the next few weeks, actually the next few months, the Shiloh elders will be presenting the 28 fundamental beliefs in seminar form. Amen? For a prayer meeting, the elders have gotten together and they will be presenting the 28 fundamental beliefs of the SDA Church. Sometimes it's good to be reminded, or maybe learn for the first time, what you believe as a Seventh-day Adventist. So we thank the elders for putting this information together. They will have material for you. See Elder Webb or Elder Washington for more information on that. Lake Region Conference camp meeting is coming up. You can go to www.lrc.sda.com/camp. That's www.lrcsda.com/camp. For more information on the camp meeting program, you will also find applications for housing on that website, as well as the program material for what's going to take place. They are also looking for individuals to work the camp this year. You will find applications for employment for the camp meeting this year, also at that website. I would be remiss if I didn't make mention of, and I know it's going to be brought up a little bit later, but I cannot pass up the opportunity to give a shout out to our PBE team. Shiloh's Trailblazers PBE team 2022 comes in again with the first place ranking. Let's just applaud our PBE team. They showed up, they showed out, God used them, God blessed them, and we praise God for what he has done for them. You know, it's not just about reading the scripture. It's about studying and then showing yourself approved. And they have done just that. We applaud you. We give you all the thanks for going and representing Shiloh well. Just a few more things. I want to give a shout out to some birthdays that took place this week. Today is the birthday of Deacon Wilbert Lewis. I don't see him here today, but he is celebrating a birthday today. His wife, Pam Lewis, had her birthday yesterday. Sister Webb's birthday was on the 27th. Sister Dillard's birthday was on the 24th. And Sister Dillard, please let us know what age you made on the 24th. 92 years young. Hallelujah. Praise God for that. Praise God for that. Are we ready to get into worship today? I can tell from Pastor Henry that he's ready to worship today. Are you ready to worship today? If you are ready to worship today, let me hear you say hallelujah. Let me hear you say thank you, Jesus. Let me hear you say praise God from whom all blessings flow. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. I don't have the energy that Pastor Henry has, but I am here today to welcome everyone on behalf of the Chicagoland Youth Federation. My name is Latita Thomas. I am your Youth Federation President here in Chicagoland. And I just want to welcome you all here and thank you all for coming. I want to thank the Shiloh Church family for opening their doors and allowing us to worship here today. To all of our young people, I just want to say, get connected to Christ. To all of our AY leaders, we need you. Our young people need you. I have a heavy burden on my heart. With COVID happening and young people, you know, churches closing down for a period of time and now we're opening, and our young people, I guess, are not quite ready to come back. But I see our Pathfinders here today and some young people in the audience, so I just want to praise God for you, but I just want to encourage you all. Youth leaders, please, please, work with your young people, call on them, check on them, encourage them to show up at church, Sabbath school, AY, all of the things that they have been kind of lax in doing for the last couple of years, we want to get them back. And it's going to take us as leaders to welcome them back and to encourage them to want to be a part of this work and to finishing the work so God can come and take us home. Amen? So on behalf, again, of all of the Federation officers, which there aren't very many, let me just say that. I need help as a Federation president. I need support. I just want to give a special thank you to Arthur Webb, Jr., because he has been a breath of fresh air to me these last few weeks. So Arthur, thank you so much. I really, really appreciate all you've done in stepping up and helping me with planning this federation. Just a couple of more announcements. Just want to acknowledge or just encourage everyone that want to send their young people to junior camp. Did not have a flyer for that, but I just want to promote junior camp. We are having junior camp July 27th through the 31st of July. July 27th through 31st, we'll have, I think, 4 or 5 days of junior camp. So go to lrcyouth.com to get information about junior camp. Send your young people. We want to be able to receive your young people and to help them to draw closer to Christ. So please go to lrcyouth.com and prepare to send your young people to junior camp. One more email address I want to put out there, chicagolandyouth@lrc.com. chicagolandyouth@lrc.com. We want to hear from you. I want to know what it is we can do to help better serve our churches in the Chicagoland area. So if you have ideas, if you have you want to participate or get involved, please email us, chicagolandyouth@lrcsda.com. I am more than willing to receive anyone that wants to participate, young and old, young people. I want you to help plan programs for you. Amen. 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 Lights and walls. So thank you all so much for being here today, and I look forward to a blessed time. Pastor Baldwin, thank you so much for preparing to bless us today. God bless you all.
I want to just take a moment to just wax that a little bit more. Latita's humble, and she won't say too much, but I want to share that being a Federation leader is something that requires a good team, and a large team, and if not a large team, a hardworking team. And Latita, I know, has sought to do this the best way that she knows how for a very long time, and she's been faithful. And sometimes I worry that sometimes the longer we serve, if we don't have the right tenets of support, sometimes it can become a little bit overbearing. And Latita serves in several arenas. I'm privileged to work with her, and she serves as my administrative assistant. That's just another name for being my boss. She serves as a Pathfinder Area Coordinator and a Federation Leader. And while I pray for her, I think it's a whole lot more important for me to make sure that she has the resources that she needs. And so I want to make a call today. And the call that I'm making is, if your church does not have an AY leader, please do not wait for young people to show up to select an AY leader, because they may never come. Listen to me for a second. The job of our churches is not to wait until young people show up to elect a leader. The job is to select a leader and send them out to the community to go get young people.
Amen.
Are y'all
Amen.
Listening to me? Because our job as youth leaders is not to be the youth leaders of 20-something churches in Chicagoland. It's to be the youth leaders of people who hang out on the street corner, on the basketball courts, and walk through our local malls. That's our job. And so if you don't have a youth leader in your church, please select one who's friendly and loves young people. And I'm going to actually do one thing. Send them to Latita. She will prepare them. We will work with them. Pastor Baldwin and I will work with them. Sandru and Zakia. And we will work with them. Last year, we had 104 young people come out to junior camp. And we only prepared for 18. Are y'all listening to me? This year, we are capping it off at 100. So if you have young people who want to go, maybe even young people who can't afford to go,
yeah,
I'm asking you, just give us the names, and we're going to work it out with God and our churches to make sure that they have a good time this year. Young people make decisions at junior camp. So it's not just about go-karts, are y'all hearing me, and basketball. It's about Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. The last thing I want to do is just recognize some amazing people we have on our team that we're privileged to work with. I'm going to invite Sandra to stand and Zakia to stand. These are our right and left arms.
Yes.
This is our conference young adult leader, our conference youth leader. All right. One of them is local. The other one drove 3.5 hours to be here this morning.
Thank you.
And so we are very grateful for you guys. I think Vernicia may be here. Where's Vernicia? Vernicia, please stand. She drove 3.5 hours from Detroit, and she didn't have to be here. She wanted to support Latita and the young people of this area. So thank you for being here. It means a lot to Latita and I. We're grateful. Amen.
Okay.
I'm going to do one last thing, and I'm going to sit down and take my seat. This week was Administrative Assistant Appreciation Day. Are y'all hearing me? Y'all didn't hear me, y'all. Hello. It's easy to get up and speak. It's another thing to be working in the trenches all week long. And I'm so grateful for Latita. Her tenure long surpasses me. And she works busy all week long. And she works beyond the trenches of 9 to 5, 8 to 4, and 7 to 3. But she works throughout the weekends. And this is why I say she's not a secretary. Secretaries take notes. She's really an assistant. She travels to and from the field and doesn't ask for anything. Y'all not listening to me, y'all.
To him.
And when we're trying to work out overtime and it doesn't work out, she says, that's all right. I'm switching hats. I'm a volunteer now. Are y'all hearing me? And so I thought it was not appropriate for me to give her flowers on Monday at the office, y'all. We have something special. Come here, Pastor Baldwin. This is on behalf of Pastor Baldwin, myself, Pastor Padron, and all of Lake Region Conference. We love you, Latita, and there's nothing you can do about it. Thank you for your leadership. Thank you for your service and your faithfulness. We love the mess out of you. You're amazing, and we're going to give you flowers every moment you're alive. Amen. Amen. And I match her colors. Y'all say amen. Amen.
Happy Sabbath. Most of you know me, some of you don't. I'm Elder Deborah Davis Moody. I'm the Lake Region Conference Community Services Director. I forgot what I was there for a minute. And the disaster director and trainer. I just want to say I'm grateful to be here. Thank you, Dr. Henry, for allowing me to come today. Two things. One, I want to solicit the help of Pathfinders of Shiloh Church. When we do our two efforts that are coming up in August, we're going to need our young people to help in our pre-evangelistic activities that we're going to have for both New Hope and for Hyde Park churches. We want you to make some personal care kits. We want you to do all kinds of things. But I'll be getting in touch with your leader to let you know how we want you to help us. We want to see our young people not only become leaders in Pathfinders and Adventurers and Youth Federations, we want to see you become leaders with community services also. So we are making that development program, and we're just looking forward to working with you and being with you. The reason I'm here this morning, and I'm gonna ask my granddaughter to get ready to take that snapshot, is to recognize all of the youth from Global Youth Day from Chicagoland that worked in Benton Harbor. So if there's anyone here that worked in Benton Harbor on Global Youth Day, I want you to come up. Yeah, Latita, she's always said, well, I'm the only one that came. So I just want to be able, and I'm going to leave the other honor patches with Elder Henry. We're just going right here so Princess can get that good picture. As loud as I talk, it's the honor badge for the outreach that you did in Benton Harbor. So I just want to present it to Sister Latita and Princess. If you got that picture, that'll be great. She's right there, but she's okay.
All right.
All right. This. Okay, thank you so much. she done took my papers and everything. I just want to thank you all for enduring, and we look forward to working with you through community services for all the things that we're doing through Lake Region Conference. Praise God for the wonderful things that we do.
Hello, happy Sabbath, church. I'm really excited because I'm not Martin Luther King, but I do have a speech. I'm a youth and this is my testimony. My name is Samantha Jones and I'm 18 years old, born and raised in Inglewood, Chicago. And I'm speaking on a sport, volleyball, since nobody else wants to. A sport's amongst many other things that have been taken away from teens and kids all over Chicago and other hood areas. I believe it can help bring back unity in our communities. A lot of people will ask, how could we pull this off? But if you're opening and listening to my story, hopefully it's related to self or someone you love. I am a full-time freshman scholar in college, a hairstylist, an artist, a coach, an athlete training, and an active member in my community. I was enrolled in a speech class my second semester to get ready for this day, so please bear with me. I'm not only expressing my testimony, but sharing my experiences because I have a story to tell and I need all attention. I am a youth and I come asking for nothing more than a listening ear and support from families and communities like mine to push for more funding for athletic gear to be provided, like volleyball nets and balls provided in Southside areas of Chicago. If you genuinely have a concern of obesity, mental health, and athletic support in the Chicagoland area, or know someone who suffers from it, you stand in support with me today. I have a love for a sport I've played since I was young. And at the age of 18, I was blessed to share my volleyball skills in the Christmas of 2021 with kids, families, and friends in a village named Carmelita in the country of Belize, where my parents are from, and that's what I plan to do here. My sister and I, with the help of parents, aunties, and others who donated funds over time, were able to host a free 2-day volleyball training clinic for all kids in the community who came out, providing something to eat and a water balloon fight after the kids picked up their trash. We were also able to host a 2-day volleyball tournament for adults, bringing out the whole community, plus others who wanted to compete. The whole community came out and we were able to raise funds enough to make enough giveaway bags of dry food goods to pass out to 40 families in need on Christmas Eve. The amount of people that came out to not only compete, but to uplift and bring unity to the community made me realize my love for volleyball is bigger than me. The kids were able to run around freely at the soccer field with their friends and cousins as they chased each other out of breath. And that is what it's all about, for the sake of the kids. Because of this remarkable event, me and my family was able to host. I was interviewed by the athletic directors of all community colleges of Chicago. Many people all over the city shared and enjoyed the interview, explaining how you don't really see the love of volleyball to its fullest in the Chicagoland area because there are no nets or balls provided at most of the Chicago Park districts. And that's how I feel I can help. Growing up in Inglewood, Chicago, as a child, I would cherish volleyball games with my family because every man and woman and child were able to play and have a good time. Like majority, my parents weren't able to pay for training for me when I got older, so I had to give up on my dream of playing in college, but I never gave up on my dream, even if the people around me did. All the nearest parks around Inglewood didn't provide the equipment I needed to get better, like suburban areas. I say this today to open your eyes and bring awareness to our communities that is low-funded in a lot of things. For the sake of the kids, I say this today to bring awareness to my innocent friends who have died and haven't been able to live up to their dreams because they didn't have hope or unity in their community. Feeling like every man for themselves because of the amount of, hold on. Because of the amount of views an interest in my interview. I was later blessed to be interviewed by Channel 7 at Olive Harvey College to express my volleyball accomplishments and what I plan to do in the community. I am a youth speaking up with the help of every person listening to my cry. I want everybody to help us youth start a movement called Embracing Hood/Village Babies. Because we, the kids, teens, youth, need more support from our communities, families, and parks, districts, because it really takes a village to raise a child. Having not only volleyball nets set up, but basketball, different healthy activities, and footballs provided at parks, it is guaranteed that kids, teens, and adults will participate and be a part of the healthy event instead of other distractions. I am calling out the men especially and the youth in the community because women are always in the forefront of helping with change. But to make this work, I need you. In the midst of COVID, war with Russia and Ukraine, drug wars in the streets of Chicago, the attack of the man in the lower class households, and many other problems families deal with today, all I ask for is support. I was able to make a GoFundMe account to hopefully raise enough money to provide nets for every Southside Park district because I'm that hungry. Before my Channel 7 interview, I reminded my coach that I was going to announce my GoFundMe on TV, but she expressed that Chicago Park districts don't take private funding from organizations like GoFundMe because they have their own funding. But if that was the case, money isn't the problem for the city. We, the community, just have to make enough noise so somebody can hear and support sports activity being provided. I am here to be the voice for the youth, and I ask for nothing but moral support and help finding funding to get sports activities provided and to finally bring back unity and happiness to the same communities we live in. That's my speech. I just want to thank everybody for listening, and this is another testimony. I just put in a non-for-profit to get the name legit, and I'm just bear with me, so yeah.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Listen, first of all, how do you follow that? I mean, yeah, come on, really? Come on. Listen, I'm supposed to come up here and give you a public announcement. Okay? I'm just happy to be here. And Samantha Jones, I was hearing about her all week. I've been on the television all week, people. To deal with safety on public transportation. That's the L's, the buses, the whole nine yards. So you have violence interrupters. Tito Hardeman is the spokesman. And somehow, I'll show you how cool God is. I got the call last week to come and stand and take a stance on violence on public transportation. So Tito Hardeman said, Tank, I'm gonna bring about 10 or 12 guys. I'm gonna have some security professionals there, gonna have some community activists, the whole nine yards. I said, well, okay, fine. You know, I didn't want to upstage him. Okay, I'll bring me and two others. When we got there, show you how smooth God is. When we get there, the only people that showed up was him. So now, he gets on the microphone and he tells about what he's going to do, the whole nine yards, about the safety. And then he turns the entire press conference over to me. ABC, NBC, World News, everybody was there. And so it was key for me to say, seek God first, and then I'll add on to you everything else. So I was able to get God in there first to do the whole interview. And when I come here, I hear people like Samantha Jones, who I had already been heard was an activist in the Inglewood area, and then to physically come and see her and hear her, I'm just blown away. So I've kind of lost what I was supposed to say, but I'm just, can you guys just give her another hand? Because this is what it's about. Again, this is, so let me just jump to me and get out of here, out of you guys' sight. I am currently, I'm a former U.S. judo champion. I just got my ranking. I'm ranked third in the country and fifth in the world. I've been doing a gang of interviews all week, and it's about violence. And so there are men of God who have come out and just stepped out of their comfort zone, got off the couch, stopped eating the Twinkies and the bonbons, and have taken to the streets. And so I cannot accept this. That's just the way it is. I can't accept that. And when I see young people that have to go to school, because most people are not like Shiloh students, where they can get a ride from mommy and daddy to school. Some kids and majority kids have to be in a post-traumatic military mode to go to school. And you people know, and young people know, that you have to go through neighborhoods where there are ops. You know exactly what I'm talking about. And for a child to, he or she is only going to school to divide 3 into 15. They shouldn't have to worry about whether they're gonna be shot, beat up, questioned. That's horrible. And for some of us who only have 3 or 5 years before you retire, and you're on public transportation, and you're in survival mode before you get to work, that's unacceptable. And so it comes a time when people like people from Shiloh, the Lord has another way of tripping. He'll shut the church down so you can go outside of the church. And so, as you notice, Shiloh members have went outside of this community, outside of this church, and has caused ruckus. You have made things happen. You are doing Jesus stuff. It's the difference between a Christian and a Christian. They both are spelled the same, but a Christian talks a good game and a Christian walks it. And that's what we have at Shiloh. And I am so proud of every Pathfinder here. Man, listen, please just give them a round of applause. I mean, man, you know. Nobody is doing what you all are doing. Let me specify that. Nobody is doing what you all are doing. I can walk up to 6 people outside right now and they cannot tell me how many books are in the Bible. Nobody is praying in the morning like you are doing. Nobody's obeying their parents like you are doing. Nobody is in school listening to a teacher like you are doing. So I'm here to tell you, y'all keep up the good work, okay? Again, your jobs, parents, your jobs are what you're paid for. But your call is what you're made for. Let me slow it up. Your job is what you're paid for, but your call is what you're made for. And young people, God doesn't see you the way you see yourselves.
We don't want to belabor this service, but we know that we got to take a moment to just acknowledge and celebrate on behalf of our conference this amazing PBE team. Yeah. Every single platform that God has allowed them to not compete but to minister on has allowed them to gather another stage of representation. When they went to the area rounds, they represented Shiloh. And when they went to the conference rounds, they represented Shiloh and Chicagoland. And when they went to the union rounds, they represented Shiloh, Chicagoland, and Lake Region Conference. And we're so glad that God could allow. Someone said, little old Shiloh. Y'all know, don't pretend to be humble. This ain't little old Shiloh, okay? This is Shiloh, okay? When you got to the Nationals, you represented Shiloh, Chicagoland, Lake Region Conference, and the Lake Union Conference. It's one thing, and we believe as a team, it is one thing to say you support, but it's another thing to actually support.
Come on now.
And we said we supported, but I'm grateful you have a wonderful leader and wonderful leaders in Sister Cynthia Curran and Brother Curran and the entire team, Sister Webb and the entire team. They are very loud with their requests and requirements. They sent us an exhaustive budget and said the conference will do something. And Sister Cynthia, we were obedient to you. And we were grateful that we were able to, God has allowed us to find the funding to send your local club. We provided $6,000 from the conference for the very first time to support, not because we thought it was nice to do, but because it was the right thing to do. And we are so grateful that you represented us well. And we told them that they didn't leave Oregon as winners, they went in as winners. And so we celebrate y'all. We love y'all. And y'all keep up. Y'all, can I talk to y'all? Man, y'all kill this thing. Y'all bossed it. I'm speaking to them. Amen. Y'all just listening. Y'all bossed this thing. And we are proud of y'all. Y'all keep up the good work. And y'all don't worry about money. We'll take care of that part. Just keep doing your part. Love y'all. Blessings to y'all. We're going to invite them to come forward because we want to celebrate this amazing team. We're going to do two things. We're going to invite the young people who participated to come forward. Come, Director Curran, Coordinator Curran. All right, we want to recognize them. And if you supported them, if it was in prayer, encouragement, maybe funds, maybe calls, maybe celebrated them, if you support them in any capacity, would you stand? Would you stand? Even if you just prayed for them, would you stand? Let them see their support.
Amen. To God be the glory, great things He has done. I concur that we are so proud of our Pathfinder PBE team, all of our Pathfinders, but especially our PBE team that went to the National Division. Someone was saying this morning, again? Yes, again.
Dynasty.
Shiloh comes behind in no good thing. Amen. We look at some of the other sister churches that don't look like us, and they're expected to go to the Nationals every year, so why don't we go? So we just are so proud of our young people, and as all of those who work with the Pathfinders, my husband who puts up with me and them, Ms. Webb, she wasn't able to be here today because she had a funeral to be at, but she is awesome, phenomenal. She is the coordinator of our PBE team. And they fuss and push back, but she pushes and we make it there, amen. So we are so appreciative of her. Ms. Nicholson also went with us. She has two young people in the team. So we have Micah Nicholson, Ms. Jada Brooks, Ms. Ebony Jones, Eden Nicholson, Kai Nave, and Bill Easy, who's not here this morning. But to all of them and everyone who supported us, we thank you so much for praying for us and also for just being there. As Pastor Henry said, we have never had that kind of support from the conference financially. We've had it but we haven't had it financially. So we wanted to do something special for he and his wife, who are running around all over all the time. But I asked him what size he wore, so we're going to give him one of our hoodies, he and his wife, for supporting us in the PBE. I know Becky wasn't, is she here? She's not here, right? I asked him what size. He better told me the right size. But it has our PBE logo on it and Shiloh Trailblazers 2022.
Thank you. Love you guys.
And Latita was like, you better give him some money. So we have a shirt for you as well. So hopefully it fits. But to everyone, we just thank you for support. Pastor Baldwin, he's new coming in. We'll get you next year. But we appreciate everything that you guys are doing for us and our team. I am so proud. Where is Samantha? She is on fire. The theme this year is bent but not broken and rooted in Christ. This young lady came up through Pathfinders as well on our team. She and her sister Emma, and they were in the PBE team and took us to Nationals probably the first time in 2015 in Dallas. And so when you train up a child in the way they should go, they may stray here and there every now and then, but continue to keep them in prayer. Amen. And pray for them and push them and encourage them, and God will do them well. So we thank you. We support you in your ministry as well, and the family is here in numbers to support their children as well. So thank you, family, parents, everyone. I have something for our first elder as well, Pastor Travis. He's been supporting us. So we have something. We have a video. There's a video. All right, thank you. You may be seated.
The Lake Region Conference, the Shiloh Trailblazers. First place.
Keep going, keep going. Just step, step down.
Amen, amen. Amen, amen.
Amen.
The announcements and acknowledgments, young people, it's your day. But here in Shiloh, we focus on two things, praise and the word. Because we know you didn't just come here to give young people encouragement. We salute you today. But there are people sitting in the audience that need to give God some praise of what he did for them this week. Do I have any witnesses? Some of you all are praying through something right now, looking for a miracle, looking for God to work in your life, do something for you. And so in the middle, if you're just praising your victory, you're not exercising the faith that God requires to deliver you. You need to praise through your trial, amen? How many know what I'm talking about? So we want you to sing with us, okay? The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and tremble at his voice, and tremble at his voice. How great, come on church, is our God. Sing with me. How great is our God. Oh, see how great is our God. Sing it again now, church. Come on, sing with me, church. How great is our God. Oh, we'll see how great, how great. Come on, praise, sing. It's our God. Second verse.
The splendor, no.
The splendor of the King. Come on, church, sing this. Clothed in majesty. Clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and tremble at his voice, and tremble at his voice. Oh, how great is our God. Sing with me. Is our How do you feel? If you came here burdened, you should feel a little lighter. We're giving God praise because he deserves it. How many know God deserves our praise? How many know God deserves our praise? So I want you to sing and praise. You sit down calmly, you can stand up. But this is the time where we as a church body give God praise. Say, thank you, Father, for what you're doing, what you've done, what you haven't done yet, but what I know you're going to do. God deserves our praise. We're going to praise through our trials. Amen. You all know this song. It's real simple. My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah, it belongs to you. Yeah. My hallelujah belongs to you. And here's why. You deserve it. Yes, he does. You deserve it. You deserve it, Lord. You deserve it. Come on. My hallelujah. Sing, church.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Yes. My hallelujah belongs to you.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
That's right. Give him praise. Lift it up. My hallelujah belongs.
My hallelujah, Lord, belongs to you.
It belongs to you.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Come on, praise me. You deserve it. Heavenly choir. All of the glory belongs. My hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
on, praise team. My hallelujah. Lead them.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
My hallelujah belongs. To keep this going, but we're asking the Lord to keep this thing going. We want the Spirit of the Lord to rise. We want our praises to rise. We want them to penetrate this ceiling, because this is us performing before the heavens saying thank you. So we want it to rise. Amen. We want our praises to rise. Let the Spirit of the Lord rise among us. Let the Spirit of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King rise among us. Let it rise, yeah. Come on. Let the Spirit of the Lord rise among us. Rise among us. Let the Spirit of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King rise among us. Let it rise. Oh, let it rise. Yeah. Oh, one, two, three.
Let it rise.
Let the glory of the Lord.
Let the glory of the Lord
rise among us.
Let the glory of the Lord
rise among us.
Let
the praises of our King
rise among us.
Let it rise.
Let the glory of the Lord
rise among us.
Let the glory of the Lord
rise. God some praise this morning. Awesome.
Have mercy.
You know, I'm here to do the offering. I'll say it again, because I thought they were going to say amen and praise it just like y'all did when Pastor Henry said hello. This is offering time. You know, after hearing all this praise and worship and seeing our young people in action, the tithe and offering is not for us. It's for the Lord. The offering is what fuels the programs that fund these activities for our young people. Amen? We don't have a right to keep it. We really don't. We have to support our young people, and this is how we do it. This is how we do it. And you know, I'm getting through some technical matters here because Latita gave me some orders to give to you today. And she said, don't let the people off the hook. If you don't have any cash, we got Cash App. If you don't have Cash App, we got Zelle. If you don't got Zelle, we got checks. And we have cash if you have it right here. Let me give you the check, Cash App number. Cash App is $CYFYouth. Amen. Let me give you the Zelle. Zelle is Chicagoland Youth at LRCSDA.com if you got Zelle. If you got a check, we'll take that too. Amen. Make your check payable to the Chicagoland Youth Federation. Let us support our youth federation, not only at your local church level, but at the conference level as well. We want to make sure that we support these young people on their journey. Let me give you some scripture here, because nothing matters if we don't put the Lord in it. Amen. Leviticus 27, verse 30. Leviticus 27, verse 30. And all the tithe of the land, whether of the seed of the land or of the fruit of the tree, is the Lord's. Amen? Y'all missing y'all amen. Let me read it again. And all the tithe of the land, not some, not a little bit, not 9%, not 11%, not 6%, and all the tithe of the land, whether of the seed of the land or of the fruit of the tree, is the Lord's. Amen. There's your ministry for today. We're going to have some deacons help, or we're going to just have everybody come up and place your offering in this bucket if you have something to give today to help our young people. And then we're going to have Dave and the praise team sing us through. Amen. Let me pray for you. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day. Lord, we ask that the tithes and offerings that we have collected throughout the week, let us remit them to you right now, Lord, to help our young people advance, help our young people move, help our young people learn, help our young people be the light of the world that we are praying for them to become, Lord. Help the money that goes to the conference and goes to the church to help these programs to lift our children up, Lord, so that they can be the leaders of tomorrow. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
So real quick, you want to distinguish who goes to Shiloh and then Chicago Youthland Federation. So right on it, Chicago Youthland Federation. But this is the time when you come up right now. There's two different buckets. Okay. So the blue bucket is Chicagoland Federation. Blue bucket, Chicagoland Youth Federation. Brown bucket, Shiloh. I'm confused already. Blue bucket, Chicagoland Youth Federation. Brown bucket, Shiloh. So come on, this is the time you come and bring your gifts. Okay, come on down, Shiloh. The greatness of the Lord. I know you know this. Come on, Shiloh. Come on. Come on, church. The greatness of the Lord.
The greatness of the Lord is inconceivable.
The love that he shows.
The love that he shows is unconditional.
The power of the Lord.
The power of the Lord
is unbeatable.
Is unbeatable. Great is the God we serve.
The greatness of the Lord.
The greatness of the Lord is inconceivable.
The love that he shows. Everybody.
Hello, I'm back. I'm going to be doing ancestry prayer. Before I do ancestry prayer, I just want to shout out to my family. I appreciate all of you guys. I have my Auntie Nell, my mama, my Uncle Nick, Grandma Betty, Auntie Asia, Yvette, Grandpa, Grandma Rhoda, Emma, Uncle John, Auntie Naya, Jada, Joseph, Sean, Jada, my little sister. I mean, I won't lie, like, I always thought I always tried to look for support, but it's right, your people be right there. So I just wanna say how appreciative of not only just my family, but everybody who I'm appreciative of. Okay. If you guys aren't scared to hold hands, I would like everybody to stand up and hold hands. Even though it's COVID, I know y'all not scared of God. Just hold hands. Dear Lord, thank you for this day, this moment, every heart that has walked in the building. I want to thank you for giving me a voice that I never thought I had. Can you please be with every heart in this room battling whatever struggle that they have? Please give everyone the strength, because it's scientific facts that you have, with the faith of a mustard seed, we could get through anything. I want to thank all the love in the world that you have gave everybody to give. I want to pray for all the lost souls who feel like they don't know where they at. I pray that everybody find the healing that is necessary to grow. I thank you for everything that has come in my path and everything that you put in everybody else's path. Can you please touch everybody in this room and let them know that it's gonna be okay. Thank you for the strength. Thank you for a song to sing. And I wanna thank you for the laughter that we get to share. And please just help everyone who's fighting the fight to keep fighting. I wanna thank all of the leaders that we're able to look up to. And I wanna thank those who take the initiative to know what's right and what's wrong. And I wanna pray that everybody find peace. Amen.
I've learned two things today. I've learned that the youth and Shiloh know how to have church. And I've learned not to mess with Samantha because she rolls deep. Y'all don't mess with her, y'all. She got a whole crew over here. It is my greatest pleasure to serve. I'm not sure if Latita is, I know she's somewhere running around doing something for youth ministries because she's always doing her work, but it's my privilege to serve with these two individuals. I'm so grateful to serve alongside them. We are a team, and I'm grateful that God has privileged us to grow a little bit larger. Are you all hearing me? Our youth department continues to grow, and don't get it wrong, the success of youth ministries across our conference is not dependent on directors and assistants, it's really dependent on volunteers. It's people who give of their time, their energy, their funds, and their prayers to really support young people. And it is our dream and our long-term vision that one day, if you ask, what's the dream of youth ministries? Someone said, well, we want to have youth in all the churches. I said, that's not big enough. Someone said, well, what's the dream of youth ministries? Is it to have youth churches across the conference? I said, that's not big enough. Someone said, well, then what's the dream? Is it to have a church buses so young people can get to and fro and to have community centers and gyms? That's not big enough. The dream of youth ministries across Lake Region Conference is that one day, as the book of Revelation depicts, we're going to have thousands of young people standing on the clouds of glory. And one day when we stand on heaven's clouds, God is going to say, man, who are all these young people? Who are these thousands of people? And we're going to stand up and say, these are the young people of Lake Region Conference. And he's going to say, how did they get there? And we're going to say churches like Shiloh and Hyde Park and all these churches in Chicagoland did whatever it took. They did anything short of sin.
Amen.
To make sure that every single young person in their communities were saved. And he's going to say, well done. And so it is always my greatest privilege to help and to celebrate. Here's what I want to say. There are four things we do not do in the shadows. Y'all listen to me. The four things we don't do in the shadows is we don't love people in the shadows. We don't serve people in the shadows. We don't appreciate people in the shadows. And we don't empower people in the shadows. We make sure that empowering people ought to be done prime time. Are you all hearing me? We want young people to know that what we're doing, we want them to do too. And so at this time, I'm gonna invite all of the church elders. I'm gonna invite all of the youth department officers and federation officers to join me on stage for this very sacred, special, and significant moment as we install our associate youth director and as we also install two very special volunteer coordinators and our CFL commissioner for this area. Would you guys please come forward? I'm gonna invite Tanya to join us down here, Pastor Baldwin to join us down here, and I'm also gonna invite my friend, Elder David Graham, to join us down here. The elders are going to join me up here, and all the conference youth department officers. Sister Cynthia, where are you hiding at? Come on up here. Come on up here. Come on up here. Sister Vernicia, join us up here. Amen. Federation officers, join us up here. We'll do this real quick.
Paul not only approved the authority that he was passing on to Timothy and taking responsibility for it, but he helped by laying hands and helping to initiate a spark and burning into a powerful ministry. Pastor Baldwin, today is being installed. We have a multi-destination installation for Pastor Baldwin and his family. I'm so grateful for our conference leadership. They work in the shadows and they're quiet about what they do. But I heart the herald and made a loud request for the past 3 years that I've been here. I said, I need help and I can't do it by myself. It's gonna burn me and my wife out. And I asked the conference for 3 years for an associate. There are some people who serve when the office is given, and there are some people who serve with or without office. And the people you see up here serve with or without office. And I'm grateful that Pastor Baldwin has been serving by my side for the past 3 years, faithfully in the trenches, behind the scenes, not to be seen. And I'm grateful that people saw and noticed it. Our conference president, Elder Garth Gabriel, our secretary, Elder Julius Ray Everett, our treasurer, Sister Yolanda Stolwall, our VP, Elder Eddie Allen, our ministerial, Dr. Michael Horton, stated, you don't need one associate. We're gonna do something special because we believe in our young people. They said, we're gonna give you two. Y'all didn't hear what I just said. We now have two associate youth directors, which means three of us can be in three separate places caring for God's flock, because young people are precious sheep to God too. And I'm so grateful that today we're installing him and his family. But I'll tell you, the greatest position you can serve in youth ministries is not of a paid worker, it is that of a volunteer. Amen. And I'm so grateful for the ministry today of Sister Tanya Loveday, who I have known for several years. Y'all celebrate this woman here, this woman of God, and the powerful ministry of my friend, Elder David Graham. Can we celebrate Brother David Graham and his wife? They look good together. Amen. I'm so grateful that Pastor Baldwin doesn't just serve by himself, but he serves with an amazing woman of God. She's amazing. And Pastor, you chose well. Let's celebrate Sister Baldwin. And I call this his youth ministry committee over here, his beautiful children. Amen. So here is the statement I will read. Accepting these offices means that you are willing and solemnly promise to serve the Lake Region Conference Youth Ministries Department, faithfully discharging all administrative duties, preaching and teaching the Word of God, balancing service to all ministries, and most of all, prioritizing the service to youth and young adults first. It states that you are committed to upholding this sacred office with excellence, God-led wisdom, integrity before God, his church, and most of all, being an example to these youth and young adults. And so at this time, it is our distinct privilege because we are installing these three individuals together. And so I'm going to ask, if you are on this stage, if you would gently just either lay hands on them or stretch your hands before them as we pray. Oh, don't be afraid to touch them, because they're going to be touching many people's lives, praying, impacting, giving good counsel. And the reason why we make this a big deal is at this moment, they no longer represent themselves and just their church. They now represent the Lake Region Conference. They have been vetted by the Human Resources Department of our conference. Background checks are in the process of being completed. Are you all hearing me? And they are insured by the Conference Adventist Risk Management as faithful practitioners. And so let us pray. Father in heaven, great is your faithfulness. God, in leadership, we don't serve higher, we serve wider. God, there's a grave danger today that with these leaders climbing in their responsibilities, that two things can happen. They can either become more holy or more hollow. And that means, to be holy, it means that they would have even more filling, even more prayer, be saturated in your word even more, and desire to seek you more faithfully. Or they can become more hollow, which means that it may go to their heads and they are just engaging in routines of religiosity. Today we pray for the first. We pray that they would become more holy. Not that they are more righteous or pious, but that they depend on you more and love you like none other. Bless their lives. Moments when they are weak, give them more strength. Moments when they feel like walking away, allow them to press closer to you. Moments when they lack resources, provide for them even further. And Father, I pray most of all that out of today, we don't have fame, but we have faithfulness. May they go where no one else goes. Father, if you send them to the crack house, let them go to the crack house. If you send them to the basketball court, let them go to the basketball court. If they've got to volunteer at the Boys and Girls Club, we're talking about ministry, Lord, I pray that they would be faithful to that call. If they've got to sit down and have Bible studies in Starbucks with non-caffeinated chai lattes, let them be obedient to your call. When young people cry, let them rush with tissues and open arms. When young people have no one else to talk to, may they find a friend in these individuals. And Father, if they've got to pull young people out of the clubs on Friday night, if they've got to help them lift up their pants from behind their behinds, if they've got to lower down the hemming from skirts, most of all, if they've got to speak the name Jesus, lay hands, pray, and love, may they do that with faithfulness. May they do what you say, go where you lead, and be faithful to what you've called them to do at all times. Father, they will not be perfect, but they will serve the perfect one. We thank you for these things. And God, we as leaders don't lay hands out of perfection. We ask even more that you would reconsecrate us, because there is nothing great about us. The only thing great about us is Jesus. So consecrate us one more time. As we lay human hands, we pray that you stretch sacred hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Let everyone say amen. Don't go anywhere at this time. I'm going to allow my leaders. I'm going to invite Sandrew to present a special certificates to our leaders at this time. And Zakiel will give a special token of appreciation to them. He is presenting them an official letter from the Lake Region Conference Administration, which welcomes them officially to the conference staff. So, Sandra, would you hold that letter up for everyone to see? An official letter from the conference administration making it official that they are part of the conference leadership, and a certificate acknowledging their installation today. Zakiya, come. If y'all want to say anything, Sandra, if you want to say anything. This is your home.
I just want to welcome everybody to our ever-growing team. I am super excited to have Tanya locally, because as Latita stated, we do need the help. Just a reminder, Tamisha Allen is our area-wide young adult coordinator, and she is out of Indianapolis. So now we have somebody here in Chicagoland as well. So just looking forward to what God's going to do.
Sandrew, I just want to say this, that I'm going to challenge you, David, that you work with that young lady, Samantha. And if we don't have nets for her, that we create a league for her and her young people, because not only is there a basketball on the CFL logo, there's a volleyball. So we need to bring volleyball back to the CFL. I don't know how many times Latita has said it. I don't know how many times Dr. A has to say it, but this is not a Federation president or executive committee. It's not a one-man show or a one-woman show. It takes a team. And for the last few years, this queen has been working without a team. I'm here today to suggest that if you are under the sound of my voice, and you are a youth or young adult, you need to be on her team. Because the worst thing that could happen is that she leaves here without work being finished. There needs to be a passing of the baton. There needs to be leadership trained so that one day she can rest and watch the ministry of the Federation continue and grow under your leadership, young people, under your leadership, young adults. Amen?
And I just want to add, I want to welcome Ms. Tanya Loveday as our young adult coordinator for the Chicagoland area.
And my brother David Graham as our CFL commissioner for the Western Division. I am looking forward to working with him as we work together for our young people here in the Chicagoland area. So thank you all for accepting these roles. Appreciate you.
Good afternoon and happy Sabbath, church. Following that installation, I have the privilege of introducing Pastor Earl Baldwin. Pastor Earl Baldwin Jr. strives to be a man after God's heart. He currently serves as the pastor of the Praise Fellowship and Bethany Chapel Church families in South Bend and Elkhart, Indiana. He strives to show the love of God wherever he goes. He has an MA in youth ministry and a BA in business administration from Andrews University. And has a passion for people, but especially enjoys working with youth. He enjoys playing basketball and table tennis in his free time, and is a diehard Knicks fan. God has used Earl and his family as agents of change to bring healing and hope back to the lives of many. He is married to the beautiful Janika Baldwin, and God has truly blessed this family with five amazing children, Gabriel, Michael, Ariel, Isabel, and Zion. This family is determined to be God's hands, feet, and body while blessed with life. And they try to live by a simple motto: do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with their God. The Lake Region Conference in February 2022 appointed Pastor Earl Baldwin Jr. as the Associate Youth and Young Adult Director. After the song of meditation, the next voice you hear will be that of Pastor Earl Baldwin Jr. Amen.
Jesus.
What a friend we have in Jesus.
All our sins and griefs to bear.
All our sins and griefs to bear.
What a privilege it is.
What a privilege it is to care.
Trouble everywhere.
Is there trouble anywhere?
Precious Jesus.
Our precious Jesus.
He is still our refuge.
Is still our refuge.
Will we take it to the Lord in prayer?
Take it to the Lord in prayer. We can
cumbered with a load of care. Never be discouraged.
We should never be discouraged when we take it to the Lord in prayer. Some days we have not because we have not.
That we bow our heads, and Father in heaven, thank you for bringing us here. Thank you for our young people. Thank you for the accolations and the acknowledgement, the pouring into young people. Thank you for the youth leadership team. But right now, Lord, we need a word from the Lord. And you have brought us your manservant, Brother Earl Baldwin, who has a passion for young people, but more importantly, he is a true man of God. So we ask that you hide him behind the cross and you speak through him. And may we be blessed today. This is my prayer. In thy son's name, we be praying for his sake.
Sabbath. Can you see me? No, I asked, can you see me? No. With all that shade I just got, my brother Webb, I want to make sure you can see me. New York basket. No, let me stop. Wrong stuff. I almost took it out. I was like, I don't want to start no fights. I want the folks to be able to hear God's word. I don't want you just to be thinking about the Knicks. But you know, y'all have to give us our credit. We didn't back down. Y'all may have beat us, but when you think about it, we didn't back down. Is that fair? Could we agree on that? No, you guys, my uncle took me to a Knicks game in the 90s. We got there early. I saw Ewing and Starks and these guys, and I was like, yo, that's my squad. And through thick and thin, through good and bad, all I could say is the Knicks have been preparing me for the kingdom. Because weeping may, let me stop. It is so good. This is my first time speaking here in Chicago. I know my friend Dr. Lee tried to get me out here a couple times and things just didn't work out, but it is so good to be here, Shiloh. Also to our Federation President, Sister Latita, let's put our hands together really quickly because it's hard. And to the team that works alongside and the team to come, you know, I am encouraged. The young lady, where is she? She disappeared. There she is. Your words touch my heart. Your words touch my heart. And I just think that, you know, when we think about all that our young people are contending with, listen to me, somebody, all that our young people are contending with, we have to go on the offensive. We have to go on the offensive as a church. We have to go on the offensive as adults because they are contending with so much. And we have someone leading the charge that is very capable in my friend, my brother, Doc Abe. Can we just put our hands together for our youth director? And this amazing team, Sandra and Zaki and the rest of the crew that may not even be here, we just want to say thank you guys for what you are doing for the kingdom. You see, folks here may not understand the work. A lot of the stuff that goes on behind the scene, they will not know, Sandra, Zakia, they would not know. But you guys pray and bleed and cry for the young people because you understand. God has allowed you to see what we are contending with. And as God continues to remove the veil, I pray that more of us will continue to contend and pray for our young people. I will be greatly remiss if I didn't shout out our trailblazers one more time. You guys, we are so proud of you guys. And again, it wasn't even because of the first place. It's just your willingness to be a trailblazer, to set the tone for others. Because you don't even know who's watching you guys. Just remember, you are setting an example for people to come. And before we jump into the word, just shout out to my beautiful wife and our kids. Ministry could be rough. I'm a PK myself, and one of the things I said I'll never do is become a pastor. I'll never become a pastor. My father, bless him, you know, we'll have family trips planned, and the phone will ring. The phone will ring, and that phone, if you know, had a hatred, a disdain for the church. Pastor, I need your help. I'm like, Daddy, we gotta go. You promised. You promised, Dad. We're going. And he said, just a moment. And that moment will, you know, that those minutes will turn to hours, and then it turns into, let's do it another time. So I grew up with that hatred. But one of the things, I stand before you now because of God's goodness. Because God has taken that frustration, God has taken that, and he has channeled it. Someone needs to hear this. Because someone else is dealing with pain in this room. Someone else is dealing with frustration. It may not be from being a PK, but you're dealing with frustration. You're dealing with pain. You are bent, but you're not broken. Because of what God is doing in your life. Pray with me, fam. Father, you know you have burdened my heart. You have burdened my mind with this message for all of our young people and for our adults as well. I pray, dear Lord, that this word will go forward uninterrupted, guided by your Holy Spirit. To touch the hearts and to touch the minds, dear Lord, that need to be touched and ministered to. I pray, dear Lord, that my weaknesses and my incompetences don't stand in the way of what you have for this moment. Lord, have your way. In Jesus' name, amen. To our praise team, to my good friend David, to the musicians, thank you guys so much for ministering. And to each of you, thank you so much for your ministry of presence. But as I was listening to the service, I could not help but to go back into the memories of my mind. Growing up, again, I grew up partly in Trinidad, but partly in New York. And I could hear some of the same frustrations that I know I felt about safety. Just going down the street, it was something special because growing up in Brooklyn, I had some cousins, and when I would come around, I was the adventurous one. Our aunts and our uncles, they say, stay around the yard. Do not leave the yard. We actually had a yard, praise God, in Brooklyn. Y'all don't understand, right? But here it is now. I will be the one. I will get on the bike, and I will try to ride around the block without my aunt and my uncle knowing, without my parents knowing. And I remember one time I was riding and two guys, they looked real friendly. They say, yo, what's up, shorty? That's a nice bike. I was like, yeah, that's my cousin's bike. He just let me ride it. He's like, shorty, can I ride it? What are you shaking your head for? You know what happened? I was like, you know what, it's not mine, so I can't let you ride it. He was like, yo, shorty, run that bike. And I grabbed hold of that bike, Sandrew, and he started to tug at that bike. When he realized he couldn't pull the bike from my hands, he went all the way back. Right across the side of my face. I just forgot my name, I forgot everything. I just knew I had to hold on to that bike. His boy standing next to him was like, yo, shorty got hard. He got hard. Just leave him alone. Leave him alone. And he's like, yo, you lucky. And they walked off. You guys, I ran into the house because I had cousins. You came with your family? I got family too. I ran into the house and I called my cousin who normally beats the bejesus out of me. I was like, yo, he can fight. Let me get him. I called my uncle, and I just knew we were about to put in work. And my cousin comes outside. My uncle comes outside. I'm like, yo, they're right there. Let's go get them. They're like, oh, no, they're too far. Let's leave them go. You know, I'm like, what? I told you they smacked me, man. Let's go get them. They're like, nah. We don't know if they have anything on them. Let's leave it alone. In that moment, the amount of disappointment that welled up inside of me, knowing that the ones that I looked up to did not fight for me, it hurt. It hurt. I was like, yo, for real? You beat me up all the time. You can't go beat them up. And there's so much that's happening in our lives and so much that's happening all around us that we don't even understand. You see, as a youngster, I didn't understand the concept of they may have had a gun. My uncle, my cousin, they were thinking ahead, but all I knew, I was like, yo, I want to get some thumbs in too. And likewise, there are things that are happening in this world right now that we do not understand. Young people, ain't no play. Our springboard today is coming from Luke chapter 22. What book? What chapter? 22. And we're gonna start at verse 31. Y'all ready to go on this walk? Let's do this. This is what the word of God declares. And it says that the Lord said, Simon, indeed, Satan has asked for you that he may sift you like what? Like wheat. Fam, listen up. This happens to be one of the scariest passages of scripture to me. It's one thing to know you have problems just in general, but to know when the bully at school says, I'm coming for you, it does something. You can't even think about your classes. You can't even enjoy your lunch. All you're thinking about, as soon as that bell rings, I gotta get out of here real quick. And here it is now, Jesus explaining to the disciples, as I said, this is just our launching point. He says, Simon, Simon, Satan desires to sift you as wheat. And I know this concept of sifting as wheat, we're far removed. We just go to Myers, we go to Costco, we just go get, you know, grain and stuff prepackaged in a bag. But back then, they had to separate that thing for themselves. They would go harvest the stuff, and it had a husk, and the grain is inside, and they had to shake it violently and toss it in the air. And what will happen? The grain is heavier, it's more dense, you guys, and it will fall back into the basket. But the husk, as they threw it into the air, the wind will blow the husk away. And that is what sifting is about. And I want you now to visualize your life. Visualize the things that you've been struggling with, understanding and looking at it through this lens of verse 31, knowing that Satan is trying to sift you as wheat. He wants to break your faith. He wants you to get to that place where you don't want to come to church no more. He wants to get you to that place where you don't want to pray or study the Bible no more. He wants to sift you. He wants to sift me as wheat. But there's something about our God. There's something about our God. There's something about our God. He throws in, he lets us understand the problem, but he hits us with that holy but. Mercy. But, he says, I prayed for you. I prayed for you that your faith would not fail. This is Jesus speaking to you and to me. You have to understand here, in as we look at the background of this word you in that text, it makes it sound so specific to Peter, but it's actually in the plural. So he's actually speaking to all believers. Satan wants to sift all believers. And Jesus is saying, I've prayed for you that your faith will not fail. And when you have returned to me, he says, strengthen your brethren. It's not just about getting strong for ourselves. We have to be available to help those that are less fortunate. We have to step in, youngsters, for that kid who's getting bullied at school. You may have to walk an extra 2 blocks to make sure that girl doesn't have to walk to her apartment by herself. Why? Because it's not just about ourselves. To that leader who's tired and you're like, you know what, forget this. Don't give up. Our children need it. If you give up and they give up, what happens to our children? As I said, this is just a launching point, because I want to go to a passage of scripture that is pretty well known. Most people will be like, oh, you going there again? Isn't that obvious? Bent but not broken, thinking about the 3 Hebrew boys. But I want you to see something that I believe is hidden in plain sight. Just like, have you ever lost something at home and you're tearing up the house, right? And when you actually find it, it was right in a really open spot. Anyone there? There's something here that I want you to understand, because Satan desires to try to destroy us. The Bible tells us he's a roaring lion, like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may what? Devour, right? So here it is now, as we understand this and understand this concept that he does not play fear. Too many of us are trying to live our lives with morals and with principles, not understanding. It almost sounds like I was going to say, do whatever, right? But no. We have to understand what the enemy is doing and how he's doing it. Because here in Daniel chapter 3, if we flip over to Daniel chapter 3, something very interesting is happening. In this book, the Bible starts to account prior to that the children of Israel were constantly turning their backs on God. They were constantly falling away, and as a result, they were taken into captivity. Someone say captivity. So we find these young men, these young boys, if you were to be taken away from your parents, will you stay up all night and watch TV all night? Will you be in the PS5 all night? Will you eat all the candy that your heart is content with? You see, sometimes we only do the right thing because we are around responsible adults. But here it is now. These young men have been taken away from their homes, and we're picking it up in chapter 3, and an interesting thing is happening. The Bible says that King Nebuchadnezzar made a big old statue, and he invited all of these people to come. And when the music played, what was supposed to happen, Pathfinders, Trailblazers, what was supposed to happen? Trailblazers, what was supposed to happen? Bow. Come on, y'all, Trailblazers, what was supposed to happen? Nice and loud. Bow. Bow down when the music played. And that is no different. Remember this, the Bible says there's nothing new under the sun. And Satan still wants you to bow down. He still wants me to bow down. And he wants you to do it voluntarily. And if you don't want to do it voluntarily, he will bend you himself. But here it is now. I want you to pay attention to the very beginning of the chapter. Because Nebuchadnezzar invites the administrators, the leaders, and all of these different people. Similar to what happens now. Do y'all know how changes happen? When I grew up, let me just put some context to this. When I grew up, I'm 40-something, right? Our style was to wear baggy pants. Your pants will be so big, you buy like, you know, you might be a waist 32, you buying like 42. And you have to pull that material like this and grab that belt and hook it on. But when you walk, you get and now today, you'll wear pants that I can see a DNA. Y'all can't even, y'all have to like do a dance or put your hands in your pocket. How did that change happen? How did that change happen? You see, they get people of influence to start to wear it. They get people of influence to start to endorse it. They get the sports stars. They get that music star. They get leaders to endorse it. And then all of a sudden, before you know it, it becomes the norm. But this is what I want us to walk away with now. As we look at these young men, I want us to understand that they represent the elite class. Someone say elite. They represent a group of people that are not willing to compromise their beliefs, their upbringing, their training. Is there any such young people here today? You are unapologetic about your love for Jesus Christ. You're not like this preacher who, when I was coming up, I used to hide my Bible. I used to take my jacket off when I have to go through town because I didn't want them to know I was a church boy. They stood up, and what they said was, you know, it doesn't matter what you do to us, we are not going to bow down, but I want you to pay attention to the initial invitation, young people. Because at the beginning of this chapter, this invitation goes out to all of these people, but in nowhere in that invitation does it state that if you don't bow down, you're going to get thrown into a fiery furnace. It just says, come for this inauguration. Come to my house and watch this movie. We just gonna go hang out at so-and-so's place. That's what the invitation sounds like. But young people, listen to me. The invitation and the reality is two different things. Because what the enemy does is he deceives. And what he does is he says, come and you can have all of this. But he doesn't tell you that that's hitting that blunt one time. Now you're addicted because someone laced it with something else. He doesn't tell you, you know what, your friend's been having sex all this time and nothing happened to them. And I know people, the very first time they went out and did something they weren't supposed to do, they got AIDS. There were a couple guys and they were going around. Listen to me how crazy this world is and how bad he wants to sift you as we. There were three guys that was HIV positive and they had a competition who could sleep with the most people. Doesn't that sound crazy? They posted in the newspaper, y'all have to hear this now. They posted in the newspaper names of a bunch of people. Schools had to shut down. He wants to sift each of us like wheat. And the invitation is one thing, but what he does behind the scenes is something else. He talks real nice. He knows the Pathfinder law. He got honors, he got the sash, and he... But what happens behind closed doors is another story. We're trying to make this plain because we have to understand that he's trying to bend us. To break us. Were it not for grace, where will we be? So here it is now. We got to keep moving. We got to keep moving because I'm just using this as a touch point because too often I've heard preachers glorify the foolishness they used to do by saying stuff like this, when I used to have fun. Young people, I apologize on behalf of adults who have said that. Including myself. When I used to be in the club and have fun. What are you saying? What is the message that we're communicating to our young people? You see, the thing about it is we have glorified, I grew up in church. The people with the best testimonies. The ones who came off the street, they talk about, yeah, and God, and the gun just jammed, and you're like, what? I was like, yo, I want a testimony like that. Not just showing up to church, it's my happy Sabbath. But the problem is we have glorified sin intentionally and unintentionally. And what I want to let someone know today, it's okay to be Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. It's okay not to bow your knees to the music. It's okay to try to live your life for God. It's okay. That's the right way to do it. But the reality is this. The majority of us not gonna make that cut. What we do with that? Is there any space in the team, coach? Could I play still? I messed up. I was the one bullying people at school. I was the one cutting up in class. I was the one smoking. I was the one drinking. Is there still an opportunity for me, God, or is it too late? My family is broken. I don't even have my parents in the house. But do you realize that those boys came from a broken home? They didn't have their parents around, but they had a resolve in them because of the Holy Spirit. You can stand, young people. Even when the adults around you are bowing down and you're looking at the leaders around you and you're like, you're, no way they're going to bow down. And you see them bowing. Oh, my goodness. Stand firm. Don't be afraid, you guys, because I promise you, people may clown you as on your journey, but they will celebrate your destination. But we're not stopping there, because we're trying to touch the entire spectrum, young people. The elite, that is the minority. And we're going to come down on this side right here. This side right here. I'm not trying to talk about this side of the church. I'm just talking about this side of the continuum, because too many of us have become complacent with our walk with God. We don't look at this thing as life and death anymore. We think, you know, we'll be here next week. I was here 2 days ago to bury a young man that I just knew I was going to see later on. I lift up the Talbots, I lift up the Suggs. Why? Because that young man was... The devil wants to sift us as wheat. And here it is now. Too many of us have grown accustomed to the reality that we have gotten away with sin, and now we think it's okay. And I'm going to jump. I'm just touching on some scriptures, and I'm going to jump all the way to Acts chapter 19. Acts chapter what? Acts chapter 19, the Bible says that he was doing amazing things by the hand of Paul. Handkerchiefs that touched him, they were taking it and healing the sick. And some young people who grew up in the church, they knew about God, but they didn't know God, decided to do something pretty interesting. The Bible says that they will go around and they will cast demons out of people. The way the scripture reads, it sounds like they had some success doing this before. But I want you to get this now. The devil will always call our bluff. Because the Bible says in Acts chapter 19 that these seven sons of Sceva, they come to this house, they come to this man who is demon-possessed, and the Bible says that when he was finished and done, he beat them, stripped them naked, and sent them out of the house running for their lives. I could only hear the young people say, emotional damage. But guess what? Guess what? Guess what? I read the Bible, and when I read the Bible, I just can't just look at the verses just like that. I start to use my imagination. Let me ask y'all, 1, 2, 3, 4, I'm picking up my guys, 5, 6, 7. If you guys were to walk into a house, and you start to see, what's your name? Ronnie starts to get beaten, his clothes is getting stripped off. Ronnie's screaming, help, help. Come on, Sandrew. What are you doing? You're helping him? What are you doing? Helping him, what are you doing? Helping him, what are you doing? Helping him, what are you doing? You're gonna help him? Trailblazers, that's what's up. Shiloh, you're training them right, because I'm gone. I'm gone. I'll help maybe, like, let's throw that running, I'm gone. But as I read this story, David, something interesting happens because the Bible says that all of them got beaten up, all of them were stripped naked, and I have to say, how does that happen? Here comes the imagination. So imagine now they walking into this house and they're all confident because they're trailblazers, they're pathfinders, they know their Bible. I'm just picking on y'all just a little bit. So they walk into the house and they're quoting scriptures. What does John 3:16 say? There you go. They saying all of these texts and the guy is talking like this. Oh, please. Please, no, please don't hurt me, please. Because I want you to understand the enemy tries to pretend that he is weak to set us up. So he walks and he says, oh, please. And they walk into the house, they have their Bible, and they're walking proud. And he walks over this way, Spence, and he locks the window. Oh, please. Oh, no, please don't hurt me. I'm just a weak. And he locks this window. And they're following him around, and they're quoting texts about Jesus who Paul proclaims. And he comes around, and he locks the front door. Oh, please, oh, please. By the second window, some of them were like, yo, this is different. Keep praying, don't worry. We got this. You remember, Jesus who Paul proclaims. And now all of a sudden he's talking, oh, please, oh, please, oh, please. And as the door locks, Latita, all of a sudden they hear, Jesus, I know. Paul, I recognize, but who are you? Goosebumps, anyone? Goosebumps, anyone? Let me explain to you something. To some of the adults in this room right now, you have been in places where you know you wasn't supposed to be. And you have heard and felt that spirit move. And you're like, Lord, help. If you get me out of this one, I'll be in church next week. Lord, please. When you go up to the clinic. When you go to the clinic and you start to think about all the people you were with, and you're like, oh my goodness, Lord. I'm dumb. Why did I do that? But you say, but God, if you could please get me out of this one, I ain't gonna do it no more. It may not even be that extreme. It may just be, you know what, you were tempted to cheat on a test. Maybe you just wanted to you keep putting off your devotional time, your prayer time. You see, it comes in levels and it comes in stages. He doesn't just show up
like this.
He talks nicely. That show looks like a cartoon, and it looks so friendly and kid-friendly because it's a cartoon, but in the cartoon, they're using real spells of incantation and getting us accustomed to the occult. We're getting accustomed seeing demons and all types of stuff, and vampires and werewolves. Why? Because he's trying to sift us as wheat. But you guys, look at this. God in his love puts within us a level of flexibility and elasticity that even when he bends us, we don't break. Were it not for that grace and were it not for that mercy, we would have been gone long time. If God were to pull back the veil, just heading to church right now, demons didn't want you hearing this message. But angels that exceeded in might and strength just said, not this one. Not that one. They have an appointment at Shiloh today. I have a purpose for their lives. I need for them to set up volleyball nets. And to empower our young people to know that there's more in life than just selling bags and picking up guns. So our mistakes don't disqualify us, but they can refine us. You guys, I don't envy the times that you guys are living in. I had to work hard to get into trouble. No, y'all have to understand this. Those little devices, you know what access y'all have to that, like the world? Y'all don't have to go into the library and get a little index card and go look. Y'all could get into trouble without even trying because stuff starts to pop up. And it just says click. Click. The deck is stacked against you. But as the adults, as the youth leaders, we are not going to stand by. I'm going to ask my musician, let's just start to touch those keys. Let's just do something with those keys for me. We're not just going to stand by and do nothing. We're not going to do like my cousin and my uncle and say, yo, they're down the block, you know. Don't worry about it. We want to stand in the gap for you. We want you to understand mistakes that we have made. Too often our young people, you know what? All they see is the good side of us. We think that we can only lead from strength, so we hide our mistakes and we try to show them this perfect image. And what it actually does, it makes our young people lose hope because they say, I can never be like that. But they didn't understand the struggle. They didn't understand what it took for you to look the way you look right now. They didn't understand you were the one coming to the church with the short skirt one time. And every generation looks down on the other generation. I'm like, why? My father, they used to be like, what's wrong with your outfit? Till one day I was under the staircase and I found a bin with some pictures. And I found my parents who were talking about my clothes in platform shoes, bell-bottom pants, afros with the fist, you know, the pick. I'm like, hold up. That's okay, but this ain't. We need to stop putting generation against generation. And we need to get to a mindset that we are in this thing together. Watch this. When we come together, do you realize the power? Because God has deposited within each of us a gift. And that gift is for the edification of the church. And that's a fancy word for building up the church. So imagine that 1,000-piece puzzle. Who like puzzles? Imagine if everyone here was given a piece of the puzzle. And they were told to show up to church next week. And as we come to church, we start to put the pieces together. Who has the edge? And we get the edges in place first. And then we start to put it together. And we're like, we're almost there, but there's a section missing. Young people, you are that section. You are that section. The picture is not complete unless you are there. Don't listen to the lies that you're insignificant. Your church is at a disadvantage without your commitment. Your church and your family, come on, families. Young people, you can tell your parents it's time to pray. It's time to worship, because sometimes we need help too. The Bible tells us in Genesis that God said that it was nothing that they could not do because they were of one accord. Listen to me, somebody. But their hearts were continuously evil. So God had to separate all of this and split the languages, but I want us to understand the power in what the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords just said. There's nothing that they cannot do when they are of one accord. We have to stand hand in hand. We have to take a position where we are protecting the weak. And when we are strengthened, we must fight. And when we are strengthened, we must fight. We can't sit back and say, I'm tired. I can't be an AY leader. I'm tired. I can't be this because I'm tired. Is there breath in your body? Yes. Then there's something for you to do. We're going to take a cue from nature right now. A little different, but y'all going to bear with me, right? We're ending right now. I love the Discovery Channel. I love the Discovery Channel. And as a Adventist, y'all know how rough it is sometimes on Sabbath. You can't watch nothing. But we could watch the Discovery Channel. So it's in those moments I saw certain lessons that I think the church misses. Because on the channel, there's the buffalo, and y'all got the bulls here, so I thought there would be a good correlation, bulls and the buffalo. But watch this now. When the lions come,
yeah.
When the lion, the king of the jungle comes, it blows my mind that the lion does not pick, where's the strongest buffalo? Where's the one who knows all 66 books? Where's the one who shows up to prayer meeting? Where's the one? He's looking for the one struggling to pray. He's looking for the one who's questioning whether or not God is real. And as they zone in, as if a message goes out, and they zone in on the weakest, separating it from the, come on, separating. Listen to me. I am tired of our church putting people out because they got pregnant.
Preach.
That's the time to put our arms around them. When our children are struggling, why the heck are we putting them out? Nature understands this. And what does nature said? The infants, the babies, the weak, the old, get to the middle. And the adults who are strong, horns out.
Yes.
Horns out. And they meet those lions with horns facing out. They make a circle around the weak. they make a circle around the vulnerable. And they simply says, come. No, no, for real. Lions, you think lions are tough, but when a buffalo gets, woo! But they say horns out. Young people, I want you to do this. I want you to stand up for me. If you're under the age of 25 or 35, stand up. Adults, we're about to do something phenomenal. The enemy is not gonna like this. But we are gonna make a circle around this place. All my adults, get to the outside corners. Horns out. Horns out represents prayer. Horns out represents studying. Horns out represents service. We're doing something. We're sending a message to the world, seen and unseen, that no longer are we gonna sit back and do nothing. Our young people are in the middle. Squeeze to the middle, young people. Squeeze to the middle. Horns out. Horns out, adults. When they come to us saying that they're struggling with their identity, come on, somebody.
Yeah, yeah.
So y'all didn't hear that one, right?
Yeah.
When they say, well, I'm not sure if I identify as.
Yes, yes.
That's time to put our arms around them and start loving in them. There should be no problem that they have that we are not willing to contend with in Jesus' name. Young people, look around. Look around. Look around. This is your church. This is your area. Look around. And we are standing here to simply say, we are not going to stand by and let the enemy divide you from us. We're going to take a position. Horns out. We're going to pray for you during the week. Too much times we have energy to talk about them negatively, but when they do some good, we stay quiet. Horns out. You may be bent, but we are not broken. Even those that are outside, they may be bent, but they're not broken, because Jesus has the final say. Jesus has the final say. My brother, we have a director that loves you. We have a team that loves you, church leaders that love you. And we stand today to declare and decree we're in this together. We're having two prayers right now. But before we pray, I need to just ask this important question to this group in the middle. To this group in the middle. Does anyone here want to say right now, I choose Jesus? I choose Jesus. If that's you, just put your hand up. I see your hands. That's what's up. That's what's up. I choose Jesus. I want you guys to remember this moment, because heaven is taking account. To those on the outside, right now, take this time to maybe say a silent prayer, asking God, God, forgive me for not being there. Forgive me for not setting the right example, for telling them the right thing, but not showing them the right thing. We're praying silently right now. But here comes the next part. You're going to hold your hand up if you promise to do better. In Jesus' name. To those on the outside, you said, I want to do better, God. Help me. So we're going to have two prayers right now. I'm going to ask Sandrew to say a prayer for our young people. And I'm going to ask our elder to say a prayer for our adults. While they are praying out loud, we are all praying in our hearts. The devil doesn't like prayer, y'all, but God loves it. Who are we gonna serve?
Before we begin to pray, young people, I want you to take 10 seconds to do this. Because right now you have a lot of things running through your mind. The devil is popping open memories and thoughts that you used to think, that you thought yesterday, that you're thinking about after. I want you to take 10 seconds and just ask the Lord to quiet the noise. To quiet the noise in your heart and your mind so that your prayers can be heard at this time. So for the next 10 seconds, we just want you to take some time. Ask the Lord to quiet the noise in your heart and your mind so that this prayer from your lips, from my lips to your heart, to God's ears, can be heard and He can move on your behalf. Father in heaven, we come before you now thanking you for one more day, for one more chance to get it right. We're rejoicing in your presence, Lord, that in your waking us up on this Sabbath day, you allowed us to move freely from our beds to the bathrooms, from the bathrooms to the dressing rooms, from the dressing rooms to the cars, from the cars to church. And now we're here in your presence, Holy Spirit, in need of a move of your touch and your hand on our lives. The young people right now, Holy Spirit, are needing of you, of your hedge of protection around them in school and at home. Lord, I saw young people raising their hands halfway when they said they choose Jesus. Lord, let them not, give them the courage to not be afraid to declare that they stand for you. Jesus, I ask you to continue to shed blood on their behalf so they can grow boldly like those three young men who stood and said, I will not kneel, I will not bow, and I will not worship. Father, we ask you now, we know that they are dealing with some things that I can't even imagine having to comprehend to deal with. But Lord, as you are preparing these young warriors, these trailblazers, these young people in the Chicagoland area to take the Shy out of Chirac and put God back into Chicago, amen, that this community, that this city will be won by these young people on your behalf, so they can stand boldly and watch the others say, I want to serve the God of these young people, of the trailblazers of Shiloh, of the trailblazers of Chicagoland, Father. We ask you that, Lord, whatever's going on inside of their houses, that, Lord, you let them be the ones that quiet the noise. Let them be the ones praying for their parents. Let them be the spiritual leaders until mom and dad steps up. Lord, let them go boldly for these next few weeks of school. Let them prepare their hearts and minds for ministry and to be an example this summer in this area. Lord, let not the spirit of fear surround them or encompass them. Lord, let the joy of God go before them so they can do a mighty work in your name in these last days. In Jesus' name.
Father, as we continue this prayer, Lord, we've prayed for the young people, but also, God, we pause to pray for the adults. Father, you have charged them not just to rebuke and reprove, but to love. You've charged them to protect. You've charged them to prosper our young people. So, Father, at this moment, we ask that you would grant us that which we need to provide that which they need, so that they can grow in an environment, so that they can prosper in an environment that you have ordained for them. Lord, we are just vessels in your hands. And so, Father, we pause right now to say, come down, fount of every blessing. Tune our hearts to sing thy praise. But, Father, we ask that you would give us the strength that we need to encourage our young people. So, Lord, that they may go on to do even greater things than we. Father, we're not perfect. We never claim to be perfect. And we don't want them to see us as perfect. We want them to see us as sinners saved by grace. Mistakes will be made, but God saves. Mistakes will be made, but God forgives. Mistakes will be made, but God shed his blood so that we might have a right to the tree of life. Bless us, Father. Bless us to that end. Forgive us for our sins. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And may we meet you in peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
I thank you for standing. I thank you for declaring that we choose Jesus. Let's go in his love. Let's go in his strength. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you.
I am so glad to have been in the house of the Lord today. Amen. Amen. I am going to get ready to close us out, but I do have one announcement. Our team would like to meet with all of the young adults that are in the house today. So if you are 18 to 35-ish, we'd like for you to, we just want to connect with you. We don't want to leave without connecting face-to-face personally with you today. So if you could just meet where Sandrew was sitting, right here up front after service, that would be great. All right. If you could stand and bow your head. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for another day of life. We thank you that we are able to stand here in worship together today. We are so filled, and we just thank you for what you have done. We thank you for what you're going to do, and we just ask that you would go before us, continue to guide and direct us, Lord, as leaders, as parents, and just partners in ministry, Lord. We ask that you would take us from this place safely to wherever we may go throughout the rest of this day. And again, we are just most grateful, Lord, for our youth and our young adults who have made commitments today and taken stands today, God. And we just ask that you would continue to strengthen them to be beacons of light in their communities and everywhere that they would go. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You are dismissed.
Left face. out here.